Dear devotees, once again you have invited me to deliver this talk in conjunction with the forthcoming Vesak celebration. This year you have invited me on behalf of YBM Vesak Celebration Committee. I remember I have given several talks for the last few years. Celebration of Vesak. I can remember 1950s, only Penang was the Vesak holiday that people enjoy as a religious day. But in other states, people had no chance at that time. That means Buddhists in Penang were more active from the very beginning. When I wanted to start the Buddhist Missionary Society in 1961, most of those founder members of the Buddhist Missionary Society were Penang people who were staying in Kuala Lumpur. So, Buddhism is established long ago in this island. So it is your duty to continue and maintain this noble heritage. In India, 2,500 years ago, there were very active religions, not only one religion. Buddhism was one of those religions. Hinduism, Jainism, Brahminism, were very active all over the country. But people have not chosen the other existing religions, but only accepted Buddhism. Now this is a very important point. The religion which was originated in India, why Chinese in China about 2,000 years ago accepted this religion? Why did they not chosen? They have not chosen Jainism, Hinduism, Brahminism. The main reason is their religion, religious belief, religious practices, traditions were confined according to Indian way of life. The Buddha did not introduce a religion just for people to follow. By following the Indian traditions and Indian way of life, it is the universal message for the whole mankind, whole world. That is why people in China and Korea and Japan and Mongolia and Tibet and Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, and Vietnam, Cambodia, and many other countries chosen only Buddhism. The reason is, it is a universal message that can be practiced by any human beings in any part of the world. Today, Buddhism is a very popular religion in the West. There are no missionaries, no orphanages or old folks homes or schools to introduce religion. Simply by reading some booklet or after listening to a religious talk, people come to know that this is the religion that they need. Because when scientific education opened their mind, they were not ready to accept religious dogmas, superstitious belief, age-old traditions as religious beliefs, because they have learned how to analyze by using their scientific knowledge. There is a name for the Buddha, Vijjācharana Sampanna, amongst those 9 virtues or characteristics of the Buddha. One of them is Vijjācharana Sampanna, one who has cultivated moral conduct and wisdom together. Why it is mentioned? You can study very carefully. Founders of any other religions in this world, or all those philosophers, great thinkers, scientists, and rationalists, whether you can find these 2 qualities equally. If people are very wise, very intelligent, there are human weaknesses in them, either egoism or anger or jealousy or narrow-mindedness. Some sort of human weaknesses can find in many of them. If people are very kind and compassionate and all the good qualities that they maintain, then we can understand their character is poor. But some others are very fortunate to develop their character, behavior, but their knowledge, wisdom, understandings are limited. So these 2 equally we can find only in the Buddha. There is nobody in this world who can pinpoint any human weakness in the Buddha's character. On the other hand, there is nobody in this world who can say the Buddha cannot understand this. That is why equally he maintained wisdom and character, Vijjācharana. By realizing this, intellectuals all over the world appreciate, although they do not become Buddhists at once, they respect, they pay homage, they appreciate the Buddha and his teaching. So the Vesak is the day that we celebrate as a religious day. It is not a festival. Therefore, people to enjoy their life by drinking and dancing and slaughtering animals. This is a day for people to be more cultured, more civilized, more kind, more understanding, to maintain humane qualities, to maintain human dignity, to maintain purity in our life. There's a vast difference between all the other festivals, how they enjoy their life. To enjoy their life, they go back to their primitive stage. Why? When we were in primitive stage, we could not survive without slaughtering animals and also drinking. When all the others enjoy their festival, they start slaughtering and drinking. That's why I told you they go back to their primitive stage. But the Buddhist become more cultured, more civilized, more compassionate, more understanding when they are going to celebrate respectfully this holy day. That is called Vesak. Now we can see the difference now. So the subject tonight that you have given me, I cannot remember what it is for the topic. Just now I mentioned, don't worry, be happy. Okay? Then there is nothing to talk. It is so simple. Don't worry, be happy. Is there anything to talk? This is the problems. Why do we want to say don't worry? Because the life and the world and the nature and the element, energies, all these things create enormous problems and troubles and disturbances and conflicts and calamities. This is called existence. Otherwise, no existence. When we analyze scientifically, we can understand. Things come into existence due to combinations of certain elements and energies and friction. If there is no friction, no existence. Now we do not know the friction physically, mentally, elemental and mental friction. And these frictions and clashes, calamities, disagreements, imbalance create mental problems, physical problems. Again, internal and external. So we are in between. It is impossible for any living being to exist in this world without facing these problems. So whatever method that we adopt to avoid, it doesn't work. It is impossible for us to stop all these problems because they are natural. When the sun is very hot, if you want to go out, can you stop the heat of the sun? You have no authority. It doesn't work. But you can avoid the heat by using an umbrella. And this is the method for us to reduce many of those external disturbances that come to us by taking precaution. But internal problems we had to analyze physically and mentally. When the Buddha says, life is nothing but full of suffering, we do not take this seriously because our minds are deluded, clouded, misled, and we are crazy for certain things. Therefore, we do not take these kind of things seriously. The nature of the human mind, the Buddha has explained. After gaining his enlightenment, he wanted to survey, to see the mentality of human beings. Earlier, he never had that power in his mind. After gaining enlightenment, then he noticed their minds are not ready to digest, to receive, to understand what he realized. Then he thought, is there any meaning of telling these things to these people? Because they cannot understand. This is the nature of our mind. Now let us analyze a little bit. Our minds are completely covered, clouded with ignorance, illusions, hallucinations, imagination, craving, selfishness, anger, grudge, ill will, enmity, jealousy, intolerance, impatience. All these are the dark cloud that moving around the mind. Then the Buddha says, andabhuto ayam loko. Andabhuta means blind. This world is blind. World means human being. They are blind. Why they are blind? Because they cannot see things properly. Darkness is there in the mind. When they look at an object, they see the things as they appear, not as they are. There's a vast difference. Then I can give a simple example. When rainbow appears, I remember when we were small children, our parents and elders told us, do you know what it is? This is the vessels dropped by the God to take water from here. because they had experience, every time when they notice the rainbow, after some time there will be shout. This is the way how we have learned to see the world. That means we have no penetrative knowledge. We have no analytical knowledge. We create our own imagination. And many of those things were recorded in their holy books also, in religious books. People believe for thousands of years this earth is flat. Later, Galileo, who discovered this is not flat, this is round. Poor man had to die because of that, because religious authorities could not tolerate this. This is our way of understanding. That is why the Buddha wanted to gain enlightenment, to see the world, to understand people, to know the mind, for these purpose. Now we have no enlightenment. After gaining enlightenment, he used these five words. In Dhamma Chakka Sutta, Chakkhum Udapadi, Jnanam Udapadi, Panya Udapadi, Vijja Udapadi, Aloko Udapadi. Udapadi means arose, appeared. These five things appeared in my mind that I never had before. Chakkhum, divine eyes. Just now I mentioned, divine eyes mean the vision that we penetrate through our mental consciousness, analyze and understand what it is, not as that appear. Vast difference. So he had that knowledge. See the world. He says, the world is nothing but concept. See, when he looked at through his Buddha eyes, enlightenment, he has seen this world is nothing but concept. Vijñapti mātra. What does it mean? All these names, introduction, explanation about those things that exist in this universe, given by us by observing and watching and thinking and creating imagination. The whole world is nothing but concept. Let us take one. We say man. Then analyze. First, the combinations of mind and matter. In the matter there are four elements. In the mind there are four mental faculties. Combine. Then the formation has taken place as a figure. Then we say this is man. Analyze this man. Introduce into 32 parts all the elements and the mind into four mental faculties, separate. Then where is the man? No man there. Where is I? I is not there. That is why the Buddha, this is only concept. That name man is given by us. This word I also created by us. In reality, there is no man, there is no I, there is no you. All these are the combinations of elements, energies, mental faculties. Exist for a certain period by changing. After that, decaying. Then disintegrate, dissolve. After this dissolution, what will happen? Elements again turn into elements. But the mental energy with the ingredients in that mind proceeded. No one can stop it. Because there is energy. That energy is supported by two strong energies. Craving and karmic energy. Karmic energy push. Craving drag. Attachment support. This is the way how Buddha has analyzed this. Then proceed. That consciousness will be landed through the influence of that karmic energy. Karmic energy direct, guide. Either this way or that way or this way or that way. Then the formation take place. This is called existence. When you analyze philosophically, psychologically, doctrinally, this is the way the Buddha has introduced. This is religious language. Now let us use the scientific language. Albert Einstein, he says, when we analyze this whole world, in the end, we can notice only vibration. No world, no living beings, no matters, no elements, nothing, only vibration. See, he has come very closer to the Buddha, but he realized only that much. This is scientific analysis about the world. Charles Darwin discovered theory of evolution. But he has realized only one method. His discovery is one-way traffic. Buddhists can agree with his discovery but not complete it. He realized only the evolutions of elemental side. By following the proceeds. But he had no idea about the mental evolution. Then the Buddha says, element and the mind, both are going on evolving, changing. Then take different forms. Humans, animals, devas, spirit, ghost, this and that. Evolutions of element and mental energy. Julius Huxley, a British scholar, he says, Buddhism starts where scientists ended their discoveries. That means Buddhism has gone beyond the science, what they have discovered. I hear this is more than enough for you to understand. Theory of evolutions and the Buddha's theory of evolution. Isaac Newton, when he was sitting under the apple tree, one apple drop, then he started to think, why this one drop instead of going upward? Earlier he might have seen thousands of fruits dropping, but he never thought seriously. That day he wanted to observe. Finally, he discovered there is something we call gravity to pull the things. Before that, nobody knew that. Why the fruit dropped down instead of going upward. And this gravity also remains only a certain stage. When you carry a huge stone beyond that level, the space, you can drop that stone, it float like a piece of paper because no gravity there. So the appearance of the Buddha through his enlightenment explained the nature of existence of any forms of life or any world system. So he is called Loka Vidu, knower of the world. So it is due to lack of understanding, illusion, imagination, we create our bodies. Our imagination, suspicion, create fear. Fear appears in our mind because of strong craving, attachment, selfishness. And then go on, no end. According to the Buddha, we are burning from 11 kinds of fire every minute, every day. Burning physically and mentally. In fact, he said the whole world is burning. Agni Khandopam Sutra, the name of that discourse. Agni means fire. The whole world is burning. Yes, it is burning. Now what are the 11 kinds of fires that we burn physically and mentally? Ragocha, dosocha, mohocha, vyadhi, jaracha, maranam, picha, sokameva, parideva, dukkham, picha, domanasam, upayasa, mekadasa, agima. 11 kinds of fire. These are the names in the Buddha's language. Raga. Mostly sexual craving. Sexual urge can burn the whole body and the mind, both. Can go mad through the influence of sexual urge. It is fire. Can burn not only on life, everything. When they are mad, when they are intoxicated with lust, if there is no controlling power to train the mind, that sexual urge can burn everything. Is there anyone who can say no? Even animals. Next one. Dosa. Dosa in the Pali language meaning anger, hatred, ill will, grudge. There are many words. Anger is emotional. The anger flare up for good purpose also. It is emotional. Parents show their anger toward their children. The idea is to correct them. So we cannot take that kind of emotional anger into this group. Because the motivation, the purpose of that expression is to correct, not to harm. But we have dangerous, poisonous anger. That we call hatred. Then turn into grudge and ill will. This anger, this kind of anger can burn the whole world if there is no controlling power. Anger is so dangerous in our mind. It is like this. If you keep acid in a metal cup for a certain period, you can see that cup or the vessel is eaten by acid, make holes here and there. How dangerous it is. The anger, the grudge, the hatred, ill will that we keep in our mind damage our own mind. We do not know that. We harm our own mind by keeping that in our mind. Not only within this lifetime, hereafter, after our death also, if we die with that anger, it is impossible to be born as real human beings. That is why the Buddha says it is fire that can burn the whole life. We never realize, never think, never take seriously to understand the danger of evil forces that we are upholding in our mind. Then the next one, moha. Moha means illusions, ignorance. We have more ignorance than the other evil forces, more illusions than the other evil forces. We commit all sorts of mistakes because of that ignorance and illusion. Because the mind is coward. Mind cannot use sense of reasoning. It is coward. When the mind is influenced or attacked by our hatred or anger, at that time our mind is just like a boiling water pot. When the water is boiling, you go and peep whether you can see your shadow in the water, your face. Cannot, because water is boiling. When you have this strong anger in your mind, you cannot see things properly because the mind is boiling. You lose your sense of reasoning and understanding. You take hasty conclusion. You can become very cruel, very wicked, very dangerous because of that anger. Because no reasoning. But when we cool down, when we are normal, we realize what a great mistake we have done. Drunkard, through the influence of liquor, when no shame, no fear, no sense of reasoning, commit lot of bad things, immoral things. When that person come back to normal, regret, what a pity, I never knew that I have done this kind of bad. So our ignorance, we had to admit by reducing our egoism, because we think we are not ignorant. But I can say all of us, including me, we are ignorant. Why we are ignorant? Can you say why we are here in this world? Do you know why? Now, if you cannot understand, that means we are ignorant. Can you say why we are not happy with this life, with this world, although we have more than enough things? Do you know why? If you do not know, you are ignorant. Do you know how to get rid of all these problems and worries and unsatisfactoriness? If you do not know, then you are ignorant. Do you know what will happen to you after your death? If you do not know, you are ignorant. Now you are ready to accept, isn't it? You are ignorant, and including me. Otherwise you complain to me that I told you are ignorant. This is the nature of our mind. If we worry, if we cry because of this ignorance, because we do not try to understand things properly, the Buddha's mission is to open our mind to tell us. He says, there are two purposes for my coming to this world to become the Buddha. Only two things. To tell you why you suffer, and to tell you how to stop your suffering. Only these two things. What else do you need? Do you want Buddha to tell you how many miles far away this sun and moons were situated from this earth, and how big is this earth, how deep is the ocean? He said that enlightenment is not for this kind of, to dig out the rubbish. To tell you why you are suffering here. If you don't like to suffer, then I can tell you how to get rid of this. That is why religion is needed, my dear friends. Without this, whatever knowledge we gain, we can study all the existing religion, philosophy, psychology, science, and everything under the sun and the moon. People have landed on the moon. Did they discover anything to stop our suffering? And that is why the Buddha was not interested in worldly knowledge, those speculative ideas. Only these two things. Whole day and night we are struggling to avoid, to keep away from suffering. That is what we are doing. Eating, sleeping, taking exercise, taking medicines, taking precautions and protection. For what purpose? To avoid, to escape. That is what we are doing. So every minute we are trying to stop our death. That is called living. At any time we are ready to die. So we take precaution, we do everything to stop this. If you forget to breathe for a few minutes, see what will happen to you. It is so tender, the life. So by force, we are holding, but suffering. Every day, grumble, accuse, blame, criticize, curse with sour face, long face. Why? Why we are like this? Because of lack of understanding. Now we are here to learn something, to know something, to practice something, to avoid this unnecessary worries, suspicion, insecurity feeling, fear that we maintain throughout our life. Unhappiness, unsatisfactory. Whatever we gain, later we cannot satisfy with that. Then we want something else. That is called unsatisfactoriness. It remains throughout our life. No complete satisfaction. Today you can say you are satisfied. After a few days or a few years, you say, oh, I cannot satisfy with this. This is the nature of our existence. So ignorance is a fire which paved the way, encouraged us to burn everything. Then the next one is vyadi, sicknesses. We are scared of sicknesses. We worry about sicknesses. We get shock when we come to know, oh, we are having this sickness or that sickness, when doctors diagnose and tell us. But earlier, we have never thought that this physical body is subjected to any kinds of sicknesses. There are 5 points the Buddha has introduced for us to contemplate as meditation. that is real meditation. The meditation that many people practice today, just to calm the mind for a short period, when they go back, there is nothing. Example. Now you want to cover a green grass from a big basin. Keep for a few weeks. After a few weeks, when you open the basin, you can see the green color turn into white color. The time that you spend for your meditation is to tame the mind, to change the mind only during that period. Exactly like this grass. After 1 or 2 weeks, again you can see the grass turn into green color. That means all the rubbish again come when you occupy the mind. Another example. Assume there is a pond. The water is very pure, but covered with dry leaves. And you want to take a bucket of water. You go there and shake. And then all the dry leaves separate. There you can see clear water. You take one bucket. And after that, slowly all the rubbish again come and close the water. So the mind that we use for this meditation won't last long, short period, because we have so many rubbish around the mind. They come and occupy it again. But these five methods introduced by the Buddha is not that type of meditation. Throughout our life, the more we develop, the more we gain confidence, understanding, to get rid of worries and fear and disturbances. From our childhood, we have to start this. Vyadi dhammomi vyading anatitoti abhinnam pachyavekhitam. We have to think. We have not gone beyond the sicknesses. That means we are not free from sicknesses at any time. Any kind of sicknesses can appear, because virus, germs, bacteria exist in this body. At the same time, we have friendly bacteria as antibodies, and they fight with those bacteria and germs and virus and do not allow to create sickness. When the antibodies, friendly bacteria weaken, then sicknesses flare. It is natural. The elements in our body, the formations, is like that. So we are not free from sicknesses. The Buddha had to suffer from 12 kinds of sicknesses, because the Buddha's body is not holy. The Buddha's body is not enlightened, only the mind. Buddhahood is not in the body, it is in the mind. Sicknesses never consider whether this is a religious man or whether this is a king, makes no difference. Elements are the same. When we meditate on this, then when sicknesses appear, we do not worry, we do not cry, we never get a shock, we know how to face calmly, without worrying. through that understanding, because mind is used to it. We train the mind to face this. Janadammo mi jarang anatito ti abhinnam paccavekkhita. When we are young, we have to think. We have not gone beyond old age, decay. Step by step, gradually, slowly, we are marching, approaching towards the old age. It is natural. It is maturity. No one can stop this. God, nor the Buddha, or anybody in this world. So old age decaying is natural. And then we, through this meditation, we train the mind. When we grow old, that we don't worry. When you saw gray hairs, or hair dropping, or teeth are shaking, or the complexion is changing, wrinkles appear here and there, you go to mirror and say, what a pity, you know, now so, it is like this. Such ideas never appear if you train our mind earlier. When the Buddha going to Kusinara for passing away, at the age of 80, he was very tired and told Ananda, I feel very tired. My body is just like a worn out bullock cart. Because those days no motor cars. He used the word bullock cart. Cannot move. I am very thirsty. Then he said, he showed his body, removing his robe and showed, look at my body. See the wrinkles. You have seen me 30 to 40 years ago. Complexion, golden color, complexions at that time. Look at wrinkles now. Even the Buddha's physical body is not free from this universal nature of decay, impermanence. These are the things we have to learn, my dear friend, as Buddhism. Then that strengthen our mind, give confidence, not to worry, not to suffer. We can face them without worrying. Because these are universal law, natural occurrences. No one can stop. Then why worry about it? Bodhicharya avatara, Shanti Deva, in Mahayana Buddhism, he has written a beautiful book in Sanskrit language, Shanti Deva. He says, whenever there is a problem, instead of worrying on your problem, you must try to find out what is the cause of this problem. By worrying, you cannot stop your problem. You aggravate the problem. Try to find out what is the cause, or who is responsible for this. Then you will be able to find out the cause, then reduce worries. At the same time, he says, for certain problems, there are no solutions. They are natural. So if there are no solutions, why do you worry? Do you think by worrying you can stop them? because they are natural, then you can make up your mind without worrying, oh, they are natural. Each and every living being must face this. These are beautiful example, advices given by. These are the qualities of a bodhisattva. To develop that understanding, then marana dhammo mi maranam anatito ti abhinnam paccavekkitappa. Third one. Death is natural. I have not gone beyond that. That I am not free from death. One day, death come to me. It is natural. If there is birth, there must be death. Otherwise, there is no birth. Ending of one thing is the beginning of another thing. Remember this. Beginning of another thing is the ending of another thing. Paticca samuppada. The Buddha explained this. Because of this, that appear. Because of that, another one appear. Because of that, this appear. Albert Einstein, his theory of relativity, said that all these scientists come closer to the Buddha. Relativity depending on another thing. Things come into existence by depending on another thing, otherwise nothing to come into existence. It is relativity. Now this is the effect of the cause. My previous birth. That is the cause, this is the effect. Connects. Ending of my previous birth, beginning of this one. After this, ending of this one create another effect, another life, another existence. That is why I told you, ending is the beginning of another. Then why do we worry about this? Death is not the end of our life. Setting sun here in this country become the rising sun in another country. The same sun. Death take place here and appear in somewhere else. Because of our craving, attachment, ignorance, misunderstanding, we are scared of death, we worry about death. Otherwise, death is nothing. It is natural. It is, in simple language I can say, renewal of your passport. What else? When the passport is expired, renew with another photo. That is called death and birth, taken this way. So what we are doing here, we depart from this world when this house, not the life, when this house decay and collapse, then life runs away. Life means mental energy, life process combined together. Then ingredient, just now I mentioned, karmic energy, craving, attachment, all combined together, then goes away. Here remains only two elements. While we are living, we have four elements. But immediately after death, two elements also departed, separated. Only two elements remain. Heat. Heat element separate, otherwise death cannot take place. Wind, breathing, separated. Two elements separated. Two remains. Solid, solidity, bones and muscles. Then fluid, fluid in the body. These two things remain. After some time, fluid also disappears. No flesh, no fluid, only bones. After 50 to 60 years, excavate the graveyard and see, nothing, no bones. All the four elements disappear. So we pray and worship and do some offering in honor, out of respect, out of gratitude. Yes, that is very good. But the person is not there. He has gone. He or she carried only two things. All their properties, monies and jewelries and bank account and house, lands and titles and all those things, datoship and tansri, puansri, drop everything here. Now I have 12 titles. I know very well, after my death I cannot carry any of these titles to next world. We must understand this. But we carry only two things. The things that well done, the things that very badly done. These two things. These two things have no religion. Not necessary to use any religious name. The things we have done very badly, people say bad karma. Things we have done very well, we say good karma. That is the religious language. But without using religion also, this is common to every living being. So if good karma is heavy, then that mental consciousness will be landed in a favorable state. If the bad karmas are heavy, then that will be landed in unfortunate state. Nobody else is responsible for that. God or the Buddha or anybody. Our own mental energy supported by the karmic energy. Others have nothing to do with this. Then start to build another house, new house. 9 months they build a small house, then come out. After that go on building, because that is too small. Because we always go on expanding our houses, say exactly like this. Go on building. Gahakaraka dittosi punagehang nakahati. Under the Bodhi tree, after his enlightenment, these words came out from the Buddha's mouth. He said, now I realize who built this house. Punagehang nakahasi. I have destroyed everything that culprit cannot build any more houses. visankharagatang cittam, I empty my mind from good karma and bad karma. Let me no more fresh karma. Buddha never create either good karma or bad karma. Why? He has completed his journey. Karma has nothing to do with him. We need karma because we have craving, attachment to go again and again and again and again for our pocket expenses. We need karma, good karma. For the Buddhas and Arahantas, they have nothing to do with karma. Also never do any bad karma. Visankharagatam citta. Tanhānaṁ kaya majjaka. No more tanhā, no more craving, no more attachment in my mind for anything. Mind is pure. Natthi dāni punabhavo. No more becoming again, no more building another house. That is called nirvana. But can you understand this? Have ever think in this thing. Our duty is worrying about our life, worrying about our family, worrying about our husband and wife and children and income and property and this and that. Our minds are working only for these things. But we have got time to think about this. Now you can understand, if you worry, if you suffer, this is the reason. You had to think. You have the mind to think. So, you have to contemplate on this death. Death can come at any time. When it comes, I must train my mind to face without crying, without worrying, without fear. That is meditation. Real meditation. Then, kammasakomi kamma dayado kamma yoni kamma bandhu kamma patisarana. Karma is my good friend, nobody else who can support me. Karma is responsible for my life. There is nobody else in this world who can take the responsibility of my life. That's why karma are very important for me. Good karma support me to enjoy my life. Bad karma support for me to suffer. It is also natural. Contemplate on this. Then we know how to adjust or how to make use of our life. Without abusing, without misusing. Then the last one. Sabbehi me piyehi manapehi nana bhavo vina bhavo. This is another big problem. All our beloved ones, husband, wife, children, parents, our beloved one. One day we have to separate. Definitely we have to separate. Whatever attachment, affection, inclination, responsibilities we have, one day separate. That understanding must be there. You love your children. Strong affection, attachment, that is your life, your property. Yes, that gives emotional satisfaction. Good. But the same attachment toward your children can kill you if anything happened to one of your children. sudden death or accident or something happen, that attachment completely destroys your mind. One day, the Buddha met Visakha. I think all of you know her name, the lady who supported the Buddha, very devout Buddhist lady. She was crying. Then the Buddha asked, "Why do you cry?" "My granddaughter died. She's crying." Then the Buddha asked, "Do you know so many other children also die here in this town? How many hundreds? Do you cry for them also?" "No, I don't cry for them." "Then why do you cry for your grandchild?" "Because of that attachment." So we have to train our mind in such a way. Develop our attachment, love, affection, fulfill all our duties, responsibilities with this understanding. What is that? One day, if anything happened to separate, we must have courage to face it. That is the development of the mind. If you develop your attachment without this understanding, you go mad, you commit suicide, you suffer throughout your life because you lost your wife, lost your husband, lost your children. If not, your valuable thing, your jewelries, your money, or your bank account, your houses, burn, cry, worry. But understand this. Whatever we possess as our mind, one day we have to separate. This body, how much we like this. We are willing to spend millions of dollars to protect this. There is a nice saying, "Dhanam tajeyo mana anga hetu." To protect one limb, so one leg or one arm, people are willing to spend millions of dollars. If doctors say, "If you can spend $1 million, I can save your leg." So willing to spend millions to protect the leg. Yes. Then, angam chaje jivitam rakkama. And one day, the doctor come and tell you, "If I do not amputate your leg, your life is in danger." Now, you are willing to sacrifice your leg for the sake of your life, to protect your life. See how much you like it. Then, he said, "Angang dhanang jivitang chapi sabbang chaje naro dhamma manussaranto." But understanding people are ready to sacrifice property, limbs, the life for the sake of principle, for the sake of dharma. Because this body is a temporary formation as an object. This is not lasting one. But the life proceed. We had to protect the life, not the body. So one day we had to drop this here. Although we love this so much, but the life proceed. But we have forgotten we have a life. Pay attention to this dirty, filthy, ugly, smelly, impermanent physical body, which create enormous troubles and pains and aches and disturbances. Whole day and night washing and cleaning and polishing and applying and feeding, and whole day and night we spend to look after this. But you have forgotten, when we say you, I am not talking only to you people, the whole world. You have forgotten your life. You have to think you have a life. Body is not the life. You dirty your life, your mind, but never try to cleanse. When you dirty your body, oh, you apply all sort of things to clean. You dirty your mind through your anger, your jealousy, your grudge, your ill will and all the evil thoughts. Dirty. But you never try to remove those dirts from your mind. Remember, germs and bacteria that exist in our body also die after our death. They never follow with us for the next life. Germs and virus and bacteria never follow with us to our next life. But the germs that we maintain in our mind follow us up to the next life. See? Your anger, your jealousy, your greed, your cruelty follow. The formations of next life take place through the influence of these ingredients. Have you ever thought this? This is the nature. This has no religion. These are natural things to every living being, not only to humans. Then, these are the five. Remember, for you to contemplate, to concentrate, to meditate, to think, to understand, then you completely change your mind. Because understanding appears. After that, you don't take things so seriously. Minor incidents, now you take very seriously. That is why you worry. But after developing your mind through these five mental objects introduced by the Buddha for meditation, we never take things so seriously. Because things come and go. They appear, exist, disappear. Now you are facing a big problem. Then you worry. When such problems appear in your mind, you have to think in this way. These problems also not permanent one. Because earlier also I had so many big problems. They have gone, no more. Same thing will happen to this existing problem also. This one also disappear. That means you don't take that seriously. Let them appear and exist and disturb you, let them go. They are like waves. You can stop. When you could manage to get rid of existing problem, immediately after that, another problem will appear. Waves goes up. That is the problem. Problem arises. Waves goes down. Calm. But the force influences the water to come up again. the same energy goes up, goes down, called waves. So our mental energy is also exactly like these waves. They appear, they disturb our mind, it goes down, and then another problem appears, that term goes up and this one disappears. This is the easiest way to settle our problems, not to take so seriously. On the other hand, how long are we going to live? If we are going to spend our life by worrying and crying and lamenting and complaining, blaming, accusing, we waste our valuable life. A man who lives 100 years, how many years that person sleep day and night? One who live 100 years, how many years does he sleep day and night? Nearly half of his life, say 40 years, at least 40 years he sleeps. Then childhood, how many years we have to spend as small children, cannot understand anything, cannot do anything, cannot look after ourselves, cannot do, how many years we have to spend? Say 10 to 12 years. Again, when you grow old, after 80, 90, 100, cannot see, cannot hear, cannot talk, cannot sleep, cannot eat, cannot do anything, what can we do? How many years we spend like this? Now remains only few years. If these few years we spend by worrying and crying and fighting and quarreling and accusing and blaming, no time to attend to our life, to look after our life, to prepare for the next existence. That's why I told you we are all ignorant. We do not prepare for the next existence. All the while you are struggling, fighting, quarreling, only for this existence. After that, we get into trouble again. But if you prepare for the next one with understanding, then we can minimize, we can reduce many of these problems that we are facing. Not all. Just now I started my talk by telling you there are 11 kinds of fires. Almost every day and night burns physically and mentally. I have not explained all, I think. Ragocha, dosocha, mohocha, vyadi, jara, marana. I explain up to death. Then soka. Soka means worries. That one also explain why we worry. We worry because of our craving. We worry because of our attachment. We worry because of lack of understanding. We worry because of suspicion or fear. Otherwise, no worries. Now, just now, the young lady who introduced me, according to her, that I have no worries. But she does not know whether I got worries or not. But she also asked me to tell you the secret. My secret is this. Whenever any troubles, any problems, any accusations, any blames, any criticism come to me, I don't take that seriously into my mind. Then, no worries. Then why worry? The trouble with others, they take so seriously. God make a hell of a noise and disturbing others, suspecting others, accusing, blaming others. No end. Create more enemies. In my case, I keep quiet. Now if I lost anything, any valuable thing from my room, I don't want to ask also what happened to that. It is gone. I don't worry about that. So we had to train our mind in that way, not to take things seriously, because all are impermanent. World is impermanent, universe is impermanent, suns and moons and galaxies are impermanent, life is impermanent, body is impermanent, everything is impermanent. Then why do we want to take so seriously, as if that we are going to live a few thousands of years to enjoy our life? The existence here is, in this world, a parable is given. At night time, when a bird enters into this building, when the light is here, we can see the entrance of these birds into this building and again going through this window. But we have not seen this bird before the bird enter in this house. Also we cannot see what happened to this bird that has gone out from this building. We can see this bird only from this world to that world during this period. So existence here in this world, our life is exactly like the bird that runs through this. So we also run through this world in that way, appear, disappear, appear and disappear. But we must be wise by knowing that disappear is not the end. Reappear. If reappearance is true, then it is our duty to prepare. Not to suffer, not to worry, not to have miserable life. That we can do. That is why religion, religious knowledge, understanding are important. I think it's enough, now 10 o'clock. I started at 12 and nearly ate something, isn't it? 8:30. Any questions?
Mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata sabba buddhanu bhavena sada sutti bhavantu te bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata sabba dhammanu bhavena sada sutti bhavantu te Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata sabba sanghanu bhavena sadasvatthi bhavantu te nakkhatta yakkabhutanam pabagga nivarana parittasanu bhavena hantva te sangupaddave andunnimittam avamangalancha yochamanapo sakunasya saddho pabaggaho Dusupinanga kantang buddhanu bhavena vinasamentu dhammanu bhavena vinasamentu sanghanu bhavena vinasamentu dukkhappattata niddukkha bhayappattata nibbhaya sokappattata nissoka huntu sabbe pipanino sabbe buddha balappatta pacce karanam chayam balam Arahantanam ca tejena rakkhang bandhami sabbaso. So, good health, peaceful life and long life to all of you.